Set!
Blitz is defined as a sudden savage attack. It is indeed.
Bucky's Flavor Flav clock. I got a photo of him wearing that thing.
It's a basic primal.
Wore it to a Super Bowl party.
Man to man. No excuses are offered. None accepted.
Welcome to the latest edition.
Now, the one where they didn't find have a seat for Mark Henry big enough, so him and his family had to leave.
Now, here are your hosts, lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers.
Pure athlete, yeah.
A transcend race, hombre.
Matt Butler.
I don't talk, man. I back it up.
And we are chock full of that, man.
Damn right.
And Jeff Howe.
It's still real to me, damn it.
And that's the bottom line. Gusto, go, set some.
If you're gonna blitz, come strong, but don't come at all.
Coming strong with another edition of Longhorn Blitz with Horns247.com. I am Jeff Howe. Going to be taking you through roughly the next hour, talking Texas spring football. The Longhorns are back on the field. Times are good. Tom Herman's talking about his defensive line being too fat.
Fat shaming.
Chastising his starting quarterback. Mm-hmm. It's a new day on the 40, Rod.
A little fat shaming on the D-line. Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. I have no room to fat shame anybody. As anybody who knows me can tell. But those are Tom Herman's words, not mine. And we'll talk about them and much more on this latest edition of Longhorn Blitz with Horns247.com. Again, I'm Jeff Howell. Let me bring in the rest of the team. The master of the soundboard, the drop machine extraordinaire, the man behind the glass, Matt Butler. How are you today, sir?
Doing pretty well. I was laughing because, you know, talking about Coach Herman and the fat shaming, making fun of the linemen. I would say we were just making fun of these walls that line our studios. We had a bizarre encounter walking in and finding some opposing helmets in the studio.
Yeah, it's true. I don't know what they're here for. I haven't figured out. They've been here for a while, right?
And it's a Baylor one. That's what's funny.
No, it's a Baylor one and OU one. And I don't know who they belong to. So I think, yeah, I got a plan for these helmets.
Yes.
I'm going to ask
even
around.
You shouldn't divulge it. You should just put it on social media, what you do to these
No,
helmets.
If they don't, if two people are not going to claim them, I'm going to ask these two people about them. If they don't claim them, then I'm going to take them out, like, in the back and, like, turn on some Ghetto Boys.
Yes.
Office Space style and, like, smash them up with, like, a bat and, like, other stuff.
That's
what we're
going
to do to these Baylor and OU helmets. I don't even know why they're here. They're not signed or anything. I don't know. They're actually official. They're official, too. You can't put them on.
They're Riddell.
Because they got a bar.
They're like the Riddell replicas.
That upsets me too. So you can't even put them on. You can't even like enjoy the helmet. I can't even like, you know, throw myself in the mindset of being a football player. So that's what we're going to do if somebody doesn't claim them pretty soon.
Rod, you need to bring your helmet up here. I don't think you've worn it for a podcast yet. I know you've worn it for the buffet.
I did, yeah. Oh, we can do it for a podcast.
Wearing a helmet? Ops.
Yeah, I wear my Longhorn helmet.
I saw you were wearing a Lucha Libre mask, like a WWE man.
I went to Mexico, and I got a Lucha Libre Texans mask.
Nice.
Yeah, dude, and this is my thing. Okay, so why don't we have more Longhorn Lucha Libre masks?
I've never seen one.
Burnt orange. Never seen one.
I want to see
never
orange
seen one.
Man. Like
Spurs
green man.
Have them. Texans have them. I have my friends like, oh, you're late, bro. We've been wearing Lucha Libre masks for the Texans for like 3-4 years. So Texans have them. You know the Cowboys have them. They're all the Vaqueros. You know what I mean? They know they got them. So why don't the Longhorns have?
We need to
make these. We can make a ton of money.
That's a market.
I'm selling this Longhorn burnt orange. Now we can do burnt orange because, you know, Texans will sue you.
This is a Mark Henry project waiting to happen.
Right? What? Oh, I talked to Mark Henry yesterday. Damn it, I should have brought it up. I talked to him on the show. We need to make this happen. Longhorn Lucha Libre. I got my Lucha Libre mask. Actually.
You need to merge it together with the green man and make it a orange
Go
man.
Go ahead.
A
Rod's
going to
do part of the show in a Lucha Libre mask.
No, I got it. That's
nice.
It is. We need a Longhorn.
Put it on like for this. The cameras.
That's like the Rey Mysterio Houston Texans mask.
Oh,
yeah.
That thing's thick and nice. It
oh, dude,
like,
it's real. Dude, it's like good
sweaty
quality.
As hell down
dude,
there.
I'm
that
telling
is
you.
Nice.
This is good quality, right?
That
we
is
need
awesome.
A Longhorn one just like this. Tom Herman, you want to go viral? I know that's all you're worried about, Tom Herman.
Point
you get a Longhorn football Lucha Libre mask, brother.
That's
you get
awesome.
It. And you'll take over San Antonio, by the way.
My angle is amazing because I only see Rod through a mirror and I just see his face. So right now, all I see is Spider-Man in the studio.
Dude, this is fantastic. We're going to get a whole section of the students, like the student section, wearing Longhorn-affiliated Lucha Libre masks.
I
you
like
imagine
it.
How cool that would be?
That'd be amazing.
I feel awesome just wearing this. I feel
now
like a superhero.
You go, all those kids, they have the big masks, like, at music festivals, like, covering their face, like, these bandanas with, like, the teeth.
Oh, man.
Like, you could have a big market. That's pretty actually popular.
So, I'm trying to figure out why the Longhorns don't have Longhorn-affiliated Lucha Libre Master fandom, because every other fandom in Texas has them because of our connection with our Latino brothers.
Maybe it's an NCAA licensing thing.
It's amazing.
Oh, no, hell no. This ain't no licensing thing. Come on, man. I found this in Cabo, in Mexico. Well,
that's
in
the
city.
Licensing.
This lady had to go. She was like, I was like, she had like a lot of different teams. She had all these different teams, like crazy, the Cowboys, like the Ravens, all these teams, and like the Washington racial slurs. And I was like, hey, you ain't got the Texans? And she was like, oh, Texans? I don't know. And I was like, oh, man, I would buy one if you had the Texans. She said, oh, you buy one? I was like, yeah, if you find a Texans, I bought. Dude, she left. For like 15 minutes, came back with a Texans Lucha Libre mask.
She knows the source.
Boom. Yeah.
She's like the middleman on the street.
Yeah, so I might have been hustled. I might have overpaid for it, but I really, really wanted it.
Oh, yeah, she had to get her lick.
Yeah, I will overpay for a Longhorn-affiliated Lucha Libre mask. That is my point.
So anybody, if you're listening out there,
yes.
If you know where Rod can get a Lucha Libre mask that is burnt orange and it might have a Longhorn logo on it, please. At Rod Babers on Twitter.
Malik Jefferson, you have power in the social media. Get this done. I can see you wearing this. I can see it happening.
Yes.
We can go. And then no other college program has really got on the Lucha Libre mask yet.
Oh, the next level, right?
You know what I mean?
Will be like the Northern teams that wear the whole ski mask, just
Hell
have
yeah.
the players wearing
and
it.
And we know we've gotten to like the Ric Flair stuff. Remember when Peter Jenkins had his Ric Flair thing? So there's a wrestling connection there. I'm telling you.
Anytime you can mix in some wrestling with the football, it's a good day.
I know. I think my Lucha Libre wrestling name would be, because I'm going to be Black Scorpion. I want to be a wrestler before I want to be a football player.
Right.
Black Scorpion
is
going to be my nickname. But I figured out, because my man Mike figured this out, because he speaks Spanish and I do not. Do y'all speak Spanish? You speak Spanish?
I don't, no.
Okay.
I should, but
I'm supposed to, but yeah.
It's Luchador El Negron. El Luchador Negron. Yeah, it's
yes.
like a black fighter or something. That's my, yeah, Lucha Libre mask, if I wore one. So
I like
that'd
it.
That'd be cool. There you go.
Nice.
Okay, that was random.
Well,
sorry about
he's
that.
Wearing a Lucha Libre mask. That's why he's the Renaissance man of this show. Lifetime Longhorn 2002 UT All-American 2002 semifinalist.
I didn't wrestle in those things.
For the Jim Thorpe Award, fourth-round draft choice of the New York Giants in 2003. He spent his NFL career with the Giants, Lions, Bears, Bucks, Broncos, and here with the Hamilton Tiger Cats of the CFL, where a Lifetime Longhorn will be headed shortly. We'll get to that in just a minute.
I almost forgot about
this. Yes! When he was done with football, got himself yes! back to Austin, Texas in the 40 Acres where he earned his degree. He wears his T-ring proudly when he's in possession of it.
I gotta go talk to Tom Harmon
right
about
now.
My T-ring. You think
yes.
he'll be, you think he'll like show me some love? I'm
yes,
like, hey,
absolutely.
Tom Harmon, I lost my T-ring, bro. I need it. You think he'll show me some love?
Absolutely.
Okay. Definitely.
Okay. They're all about appeasing the Letterman right now.
That's true. I should go over there while I got some leverage.
Yes, exactly.
Before they come too big time and
yes.
lock us up.
If he had a T-ring, he would wear it proudly. But he is a card-carrying member of DBU, number 21 in the program, but number one in your hearts, Mr. Rod Babers. So, Rod, let's go ahead and get to it, man.
Yeah, let's
the
go,
news
dude.
The news is coming down. I just saw it
I know.
About an hour ago.
It's beautiful.
Vince Young
Amen.
Is on his way
yeah!
to Canada.
Woo!
Where, I guess, as early as tomorrow, he's
right.
finalizing his contract right now, according to reports, and as early as tomorrow,
that's right, baby.
Vince Young will be a member of the Saskatchewan Rough Riders
okay.
of
okay.
the Canadian Football
the
League.
Where the hell do I catch CFL games? Does anybody know?
You can,
like,
ESPN,
right? Does anybody know?
ESPN
3.
Does it in the summer. Yeah, it's
no, I need to
ESPN
know.
3 shows, ESPN 3 shows, if not
right?
all, a good chunk
okay.
of CFL games. If
okay.
you if you got watch Dude. ESPN, get you on ESPN
right?
3. Yeah,
you're a Longhorn fan. You're just randomly gonna be watching CFL games. And
ESPN's
gonna time.
ESPN's gonna get their digital ratings. Like, man, our ratings in Austin
right.
are through the roof right now
What's
for
going
CFL
on
games.
CFL. It'll be like when Ricky went up there.
So now that
Remember
Longhorns
that?
Aren't getting drafted, that'll just be a niche for a CFL team. I'll just go get all the Longhorns that didn't make it in the league.
Listen, I remember a few years ago when I talked to Vince Young, and this is him talking to me. He said he was not going to Canada. Wasn't happening. And he said that on other interviews too, like it wasn't going to happen, he wasn't going to do it. And, you know, as a guy who spent time in Canada, I'm a lifetime Hamilton Tiger Cat. By the way, hope this happens. Johnny Manziel, his rights, you know, are owned by the Tiger Cats. So if he wants to come back and he do it via Canada, he has to do it as a Hamilton Tiger Cat. Wouldn't it be awesome if Vince Young ended up playing Johnny Manziel in like a random Canadian football league game? Dude, we would. Everybody would want to watch that. ESPN would have to put that on prime time because everybody would want to watch VY versus Johnny Manziel. How did it happen? Canadian league football. Okay, anyway.
You said, Rod, is the porn industry of professional
exactly
football.
Right? Nobody grows up being like, man, I want to be a Canadian Football League Hall of Famer. That's what nobody grows up like that. But you ended up being a Canadian Football League, player or Hall of Famer or whatever. So I compared it to the porn industry. Nobody grows up wanting to be a porn star, trust me. But nobody grows up wanting to be a Canadian Football League star, but it happens. And I think this is a good move for VY. I really do. We've been trying to get VY to do this for like 4 years now to go to Canada.
Oh, longer than that,
yeah,
right?
I'm just.
It was at first just getting him to take a backup role or a reserve role just to stay in the game. He didn't want to do that, but then came back to do it. It just seems as if.
No, I think you're right. You're right. Because 2012.
Packers.
2012, he got cut by the Bills, and I think 13 was when he got like a cup of coffee in the preseason with the Packers.
So it's about 3 or 4 years of being like, VY, why? And he should have did it right then when he was still. You know, he was still in hot, and it was still his name was trending and all that kind of stuff because that matters.
Definitely.
But I think he's watching like the quarterbacks in the NFL and going, man, I mean, hell, I could do what Brock Osweiler did. Like, I mean, seriously.
Yeah.
If you're VY, you gotta watch Brock Osweiler and go. Listen, what was VY's record, by the way?
He's 31-19.
31-19.
So this is exactly why I think he may have came back, because I remember.
Watching Brock Osweiler.
It was a month and a half ago. It was at the end of the regular season, and they were showing top 10 winningest quarterbacks of all time. And they had, like, Brett Favre at 61% and 62%. You had Vince Young ahead of Brett Favre in the top 10. Minimum 50 starts. Vince gets just in because he's 31-19. He has a 62% winning percentage. He's eighth all time. And literally 2 days after I saw that graphic on ESPN, I saw that Vince Young was talking to Saskatchewan and interested in coming back and playing. It was like, yeah, the dude did win games in the NFL.
Unconventionally.
Yes.
Now, the thing about Canada is, not that I'm an expert on the Canadian game, but I guess I am the resident expert on the Canadian game.
Oh, yes.
You are, Rod.
This is
Rod. This is the podcast you've been waiting for. All that CFL knowledge now gets to be funneled out onto the world.
Yeah, there's tons of it. But
hey, you have a nice fraternity. Ricky Williams, Vince Young, Rod
Babers. Oh, Kwame Cavill.
The Rock.
John Childs.
The Rock played the CFL.
The Rock, the CFL, trust me, everybody is, you know, you don't brag about going to the CFL, but
how's that? How's that for a bar question? What do Ricky Williams, VY, The Rock, and Rod B have in common?
CFL, man. Who did Rock play for? Do you know? You remember?
Ooh, I want to say Calgary.
All right. I hope he was a Tiger Cat like myself.
I want to say Calgary or Toronto.
But no.
Actually, I can throw that in my Google.
It's like the Vince is on Saskatchewan. Like, it sounds like a fake state.
But usually in the CFL, because you have wider parameters with the field and longer parameters with the field.
Calgary, yes.
Yes. Usually, you got to have a good arm. Like, throw it. And VY can throw it, but his mobility, which was, you know, his dual threat ability, which was kind of the asset for him coming out, that's obviously because of Father Time, not going to be his big, you know, back asset within his skill set to depend on. But also because of CFL, man, you got to be able to throw it, baby. You got to be able to throw it. You got to be able to sling it. Like, they sling it, and it's still a lot of advantage for the pass game. Like, they got a guy that comes in motion and runs full speed at the line of scrimmage. I have to try to cover that guy.
Yeah, the slingshot guy.
Dude, that was ridiculous. That is the toughest position to cover in all of football at any level. It doesn't matter.
They get to let Belichick have that.
Dude, like, you got all that speed, and this dude can run full speed, like, around and then come to a full sprint, hit the line of scrimmage, and you got to backpedal and cover that guy? You got no shot. If that guy's a real athlete, you got no shot.
And that's why
you play pitch and catch that one guy all day long.
Rob,
be more offensive.
The CFL season, when is it? It goes through like June, right?
Yeah, it's weird because it's shorter. Yeah, you got to figure. I actually don't. Let me lie to you. You got to look it up.
I just looked it up, and they were saying the Grey Cup was played in November. You know, so I
it's a shorter. It's a shorter condensed football season.
Because VY turns 34 in May.
Ooh.
Yeah,
that's why he's in the
so
CFL.
You talk about,
I didn't think he was that old for some reason.
He's a year older than me.
But I guess he is.
He's May of 83.
I guess I was in high school hearing about VY. So
right.
Yeah, it makes sense.
So you talk about Father Time, man, and VY hasn't been on the field 2014
but he,
when he got cut by the Browns in the offseason.
But he's VY, Jeff Howe.
Yeah,
he's VY.
Canada.
His how about this thing about VY. His and Johnny Manziel's dealing with this too. We have such an affection for them. Because of what they did in college football. Because if you're a college football slash NFL
Tebow.
Fan, you always carry that baggage over to the NFL. You can't help it. Even though they're basically kind of two different games at this point, you can't help it. Different rules, different parameters of the hashes on the field, all that kind of stuff. You can't help it. So with Johnny Manziel, we are still watching and waiting on Johnny Manziel's comeback. Hell, Johnny Manziel still makes headlines. Jerry Jones is like, yeah, we're aware. Don't be surprised if Johnny Manziel ends up with the Dallas Cowboys like a practice squad. He's only been in the league 1 year. I think he's still eligible for the practice squad. You get what I'm saying? Like, and we're still following that story. Hell, Tim Tebow is going to start for the Mets today, not in their little, whatever,
Grapefruit
League or whatever it is. Yeah, and we're following that story. Why? Because we have an affection for Tim Tebow. He brought us such good times watching him. And so, you know what I mean? So many ups and downs. And the same thing about VY. We might have had our greatest thrill of ever watching college football with VY.
Yeah.
So we root for him. We want it to happen. It probably won't, but
right.
We do want it to happen. We all root for VY. And I like playing the VY freestyles on my show.
Rod, and I talked about this when he got cut by the Browns, and you and I both talked to people close to VY, and really all, I don't want to spoil it, but I think you actually talked to VY himself about this. I heard all he wanted was just one more legit shot.
Yeah, a legit shot.
To either do it or not do it.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe this is just him trying to make peace with himself. Like, look, if it's going to happen, it's going to have to happen by going to Canada. So whatever happens, happens. Just let it be. Just go up there and let the chips fall where they may.
Some people are going to make fun of this. And I probably will on my show. We'll have fun with it. We'll talk about it. But this is the thing. And everybody who's had a relationship with this game understands it.
Right,
an
there,
intimate
that's
relationship like me. I understand it.
Right.
I was at the Arena League at one point, okay? Playing in the
Palace
on Palmer, okay?
For like God's sake.
I went from 123rd overall drafted in the NFL to playing at the Palace on Palmer as a professional, okay?
With
a
dude trying to jerk you up. Be like, let's
yeah,
get this.
Yeah, like some guy who, and not this is, you know, one guy looks like Matt playing wide receiver,
yes.
The other guy looks like Jeff playing linebacker for us.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And not that that's demeaning to you guys,
compliment.
But that's where I had gotten. I was looking in the mirror as we were about to go out on the field, and I was like, Rod B., give it up, bro.
It was like you're on the
give it up.
Field.
It took that moment for me. Like, I remember that moment. I was like, wow, what are you doing?
Yeah.
Like, go back to school. Go get your degree. Like, it's time to start the next chapter. This chapter is over, in case you hadn't noticed. You went from the porn industry of football in the Canadian Football League to the straight-up sex worker.
That was going
to
be my question. What is that Arena League?
You're just a sex worker. You're straight up. You're just out there walking. You're a hooker. You're just walking the court. Hey,
yeah.
What do you want, daddy? Like, yeah, you're just terrible. So at that point, I had that epiphany. I had that come to Jesus moment. Like, come to Jesus moment. I had literally, here's a Jesus clock. Here. I had that come to Jesus moment where, you know what, Rod B., you need to give it up. Start. And it's hard. It's tough. And VY has been starting that next chapter. He's got a realty company. He's starting right now, real estate company. Vince Young Realty, I believe it is. You can go look it up. He's got the VY Steakhouse. He's working with Longhorn Network. He hasn't figured out what his passion is post football. But man, that's your first love. Football's
right.
Your first
your
love.
Your identity
and
in your life.
He's had a connection with that game for so long, and you go from having this intimate physical relationship with the game that nobody else has, that everybody envies. Everybody's like, damn, man, I wish I could play the game like he plays the game. It's almost like having a hot woman by your side. You know what I mean? Everybody's like, damn, I wish I was that dude. That dude is the... You know what I mean? And then you go from that to having this kind of, you go from basically being in the friend zone. You become like having this friend zone relationship where you watch it from afar. And
right.
You become part of, you become one of the fans. Like, oh, yeah, man, it's great to watch. And I think VY is having a tough time reconciling. And everybody does. It's tough on everybody. And I think this is part of the closure. Every long relationship has that. You know, everyone say breaking up is like Seinfeld. Great Seinfeld quote.
Yes.
Breaking up is like knocking over a Coke machine. You can't do it in one push. You got to rock it back and forth a few times, and then it goes over.
Like a Band-Aid.
Boom. That's what VY's doing. He's rocking it back and forth.
Yeah.
All right. He's almost willing to knock this thing over. but he needs to push it one more time. And hopefully, I think it'll end happily for him, whether that means happily on our ends, but from his perspective, I think it'll end well.
That's all
and
that matters.
Like, when you're talking about that identity and what comes with the game, you think about it on so many levels, too, because not only was it your job, but maybe it was, like, your love or your hobby in addition to all that. Plus, if you're really good at it, it's like maybe what you were identifying, I was elite at this, I could do this, and then to have to try to rediscover something like that afterward.
It's tough.
Like, it may just, even if you find something you like and are good, it's never going to fulfill to that peak that it was.
Nothing.
And then if now you're second guessing how it was whenever you were in that and wish you had another shot at it, it'd be something that I could not, I mean, that would, I can't even fathom how tough that would be.
Before we move on, the one thing people ask me about what I miss about football, what I miss about playing on a big stage and in DKR and playing, you know, for the Giants and the Broncos and all this stuff. What I miss most is, and you know, you can replicate a lot of things. You can go play football. I played at the Arena League level. You can go play. You can go play actually right now. You can go sign up for some league and go play football,
semi-pro,
whatever it is. If you want to replicate the camaraderie and the brotherhood, you can do that too. You can start hanging around your boys more. You guys can go play sports together, and you can kind of create that locker room feel and the camaraderie.
You once got thrown out of a kickball league game that Matt took you.
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly, because he's right. There's a difference. I don't want to get down. I want to go down that rabbit hole.
That might be came out for a split second.
Exactly, right? Black Caesar. You don't want to see Black Caesar. He shouldn't be allowed in regular society. But what you can't replicate is 50,000, 60,000, 70,000, 80,000 people, 100,000 people that are cheering you on because you made a good play. Like when I make, you know what I mean? When I make that PBU and everybody in DKR goes, yeah! Woo!
It's like the movie Gladiator.
And I, yes! I mean, you can't replicate that. I'm like Kanye West at that time. I'm a Dale. I'm a rock star. I stand in front of all these people, and I put up the hook 'em horns, and I get 40,000 people giving it back to me in a stadium. You cannot. I get chills talking about it.
You can't
replicate it. That's what. And think about VY. Think about what he had.
Yeah.
Think about that. You know what I mean? That feeling. Yeah. So for mine, you know, times 10 is what he had. So I understand what he's going
through. I hear wrestlers talk about that all the time.
Ooh,
is
yes.
the thing that you can't, no matter what avenue you go into, no matter how successful you are, walking through that curtain and hearing the crowd pop, hearing 20, 30,000 people on their feet. There's nothing you're ever going to do again that's going to replicate that feeling.
He's coming home all the way to Austin, Texas, baby.
And Vince Young had maybe the greatest performance
come on now.
In the this, greatest college now. Football game anybody has ever seen.
He was like Black Jesus for a while. He couldn't walk the streets. He literally could not walk the streets in Austin, Texas.
He's done it again.
He couldn't walk the streets. Like he literally walked the streets. He's so tall and like, you know, VY. You're like,
yeah.
Who is that guy?
And VY is easy to spot.
He's
in the crowd.
Easy to spot.
Vince Young.
I remember we had Bevo Boulevard. We used to do like a tailgate, a Texas tailgate, T-ring tailgate with all the players. We'd bring them in. And, you know, so there are a lot of times we block off a whole, basically a block party, block off a whole avenue. I think it's 18th and San Jacinto. And VY was coming one day, like, to do an interview and come hang out with us. And he had to walk through the entire stretch. This is probably, I don't know, maybe 200 yards to get to us. And he pulls up in, like, this van to get into, like, this, you know, this blocked off, the police are there, this blocked off block party. And as he starts walking through the fans, the people just converge on him. It looks like Jesus walking through like the town square. Like he's just like touching little children on their heads. And like people are like loving on him, kissing on him. And he's like
the
loving
Pope.
Yeah, he's like Longhorns. Handing them babies. He's grabbing the babies and loving on him. And like, it's just a sight. I was like, what the hell is going on? As he made his way to the stage. And people were just like, you know, I swear I saw people praising him. I mean, it was just, you know, because people love Vince Young. And because
absolutely.
Texas football matters so much, it gets to the point we're about to get to, it matters so much to people. Now the young men there now feel that weight of losing because VY kind of, you know, going back to VY, he liberated us because Texas hadn't won a championship in a really, really
35
long
years.
Time. And that's why VY, he, I don't know where his statue is going, but he's got a statue coming up somewhere
right
around
between
there.
Ricky and Earl. And
ooh, where the hell is going to be?
And you think about it, though, it just when you look at the way modern society remembers people, too, it's unfortunate because we can talk about that. And us here in Austin remember a part of that. And people do nationally. But you really nowadays are most remembered by what you did most recently. And somehow Vince Young, that is that figure. you know, at times is a punchline of a lot of people's junks, I say unfairly, but still is there. So that's got to be tough, too, that you even do accomplish all that, yet maybe aren't remembered the way that you feel that you are.
Did you say punchline of people's jokes?
Yeah.
Okay, because I kind of halfway heard you. It sounded like you said punchline of people's junks.
Joe, that'd be no that good. Was, I can pull that back to see if that is another 40 in one.
I was like, did Matt, because I was reading something. I was like, is Matt talking about people getting hit in the junk?
Punchline
like,
of what, junks. No,
what are we
Draymond
doing here?
Green.
Where are we going here?
Yeah. Not a Draymond play or a Grayson.
Remember VY in that strip club incident where some guy at a strip club threw the horns down and then he allegedly punched the guy?
It.
Exactly. Like, he got it. That's how much love people have for VY. He did something that most people were like, oh, that's outrageous. That's out of line. But no, Longhorn fans love him more. He got more credibility for that. He's like, oh, you did the horns down to VY? You get punched in the face. That's what you get.
Yeah, I was just saying, the little kid, when you lose your temper and can't control your, it just came out.
Nothing wrong with going to the script club.
Oh, man.
Just being rebellion.
I love
you. You know, I was just being rebellion.
You're right there.
Thank
right?
you, Matt.
Yeah.
Before we get into spring football, I want to get into a quick survey here real quick that EJ Holland did. We had the opening Dallas Regional last weekend. Nike's events. There's two Under Armour camps coming up. It's camp season right now. It's that kind of off the spring camp circuit before the evaluation
period
starts.
Find those freaks, though.
You know, it's funny now that I've been doing this long enough, I can remember, like, the first time I saw guys that are getting drafted now. I'll never forget. There's a quick story. Like, I don't know he's an Aggie, but this is a fun story. I remember Myles Garrett because this relates to Texas. The first time I heard about who Myles Garrett was, I can't remember. I think he was a sophomore going into his junior. Like, nobody knew who he was. And I get a call from Jake Rollerson's dad, because this is when you couldn't – Texas kind of closed off their camps to media, and they only had, like, a very select few guys. And he's like, what do you know about Myles Garrett? I'm like, nothing. Why? He's like, this kid's a freak. Like, he's the best player here. He's the best looking kid here. It's from Arlington Martin. Like, he's the best. I'm not even sure what class he's in. He's the best prospect here. I'm like, okay. So I did kind of some research, and I never forget. So Myles Garrett plays his junior year. I go see him in an off-season workout. This is probably February of his junior year before his senior season. And it's probably 35, 40 degrees outside. It's a cold day in Arlington. And he's on the field, like after working out by himself.
Mm-hmm.
And he's running sprints. He's running sprints with just, like, a pair of basketball shorts and cleats. And I'm like, how old is this kid? And the Martin coach, Coach Wager at Martin, he's like, well, he's, you know, 16. I'm like, I want to see the birth certificate. Like, there's no way.
It's like
no
a Bo Jackson
way.
Story.
There's no way.
The coach,
he's 16 years
it's
old.
It's like a scene out of a movie.
Like, he looks like a junior in college right now. Like, it's ridiculous.
It's like
so,
a story you heard from Bo Jackson's, his high school coach that had inherited the team. He shows up, and then he's like, oh, well, who's that guy? Thinking it's another coach working out there. And then they're like, oh, that's Bo Jackson. He's like, Bo Jackson? Yeah. He's like, yeah, he's going to be a junior next year.
So that's the kind of stuff you see when you're out and about during the spring.
That's great.
But just real quick, so EJ Holland, our outstanding recruiting editor at Horns247.com, he's also handling some regional duties for 24/7 Sports. He took a poll of 16 Power 5 recruits, all 16 of them hold Power 5 offers, and just kind of polled them on a variety of different topics. One question in the poll, and this is a multiple-part survey, so one question in the survey was, who will have more success, Tom Herman or Matt Rhule? 87% of the recruits said Tom Herman. One quote from a recruit, you have to go with Herman. He's going to get it done. He wants to win more than anybody. I'm trying to see if there's anything else related to Texas in this part of the survey. Which school puts on the best visits in terms of junior day?
Oh, this is good.
Texas finished second with 19%.
Wow. That's impressive.
TCU finished first with 25%.
Fort Worth, though.
This was the quote from a recruit. It's TCU or Texas. This one is hard. Both were fun. Texas has the bigger campus. TCU has the game room, though.
The game room.
Like we were talking about, the facilities versus facilities. The city. It's all what one kid's preference is to the other.
No,
the schools that Texas beat out community. Include Alabama, Oklahoma, Baylor, Duke, Texas Tech, Penn State, UCLA, and Texas A&M.
Damn.
Which school put on the worst visit? Texas did not get any votes. You know who got the most votes for the worst visit?
Baylor?
Texas A&M. State?
Oh, oh God.
And Texas A&M tied.
Texas, really? 20%. What the hell are you going to do at Texas State on a visit?
This I was, would say Texas A&M a little surprised there.
I they was surprised should, that they were, yeah. This was a quote EJ got from
Texas
one
State
recruit.
Didn't surprise
and again, this was an anonymous survey.
We should be coming to 6th Street. What the hell are they doing?
Yeah. The quote from a recruit on A&M, quote, Texas A&M was the worst. They didn't even know who I was, end quote.
Hello. Oh, why did he say Texas State was the worst? They didn't know who
Texas
he was.
A&M.
Texas
A&M.
A&M. He didn't know who it was. The fans or
the coaches.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, that's so depersonalized.
Yeah, that's terrible. You got to come on, dude. You got to have the book with the faces in it.
Yeah.
You got to like CIA
or you at least
style.
Play it off. You can play it off by not knowing
no.
somebody's name.
That's what those like recruiting like assistants and all that. That's what your support staff are there
that's
for.
That's what your Tom Herman
they
was supposed to
you're supposed
do
to have
your
a
GA.
Book. I've seen these books. They, all these coaches don't know all these
cameramen
kids. Cameramen
have them.
They have a book full right. of faces and names.
Here's one interesting. EJ just published this a little bit ago. Which is the best program in Texas? Your winner, and this is 16 Power 5 recruits.
Oh, man.
Your
this
winner.
It's going to be disappointing.
TCU with 50%. Texas A&M and Texas tie with 19. Baylor with 12%.
Wow. TCU. Gary Patterson.
And so the interesting quote.
Eight
quote,
votes, 3-3-2.
Quote, it has to be TCU. They are winning the most.
It's about winning, baby. It's about winning.
This is recruits, man. Recruits right now, they don't know.
They don't care about history.
To bring it full circle to VY, I was talking to Caden Stearns, the outstanding safety at Cibolo Steel, who's committed to LSU. And he was telling me, I was at a camp he was participating in a few weeks ago, and we were just talking about recruiting. He's like, you know, I grew up a Texas fan. I was like, really? I was like, well, what do you remember? He's like, yeah, I mean, he said he was probably, you know, 4 or 5 when VY crossed the goal line to beat USC. He's like, I vaguely remember watching the game. I just remember Texas used to be really good.
It makes sense, though, yeah.
Texas used to be really good.
Yeah, to those kids that Vince Young's the washed-up quarterback, the old guy.
That's a great point.
Like, it's crazy.
So they don't – I mean, it's tough for these kids to remember Texas as a winner. So that just kind of gives you a glimpse into the fact that I think recruits are hopeful Tom Herman will do well. But you see there's a lot of work to do. And that work in terms of on-field results starts with spring football.
That's right, baby.
Takes us to spring football discussion. Media, we got a glimpse of practice. We got a window that was supposed to be about the equivalent of about 4 or 5 periods on Tuesday. It ended up being almost an hour because it was the longest damn stretch period I've ever seen in my life.
I've heard about this.
Stretch period typically lasts, Rod, what? 7-8 minutes?
10 minutes if you Tops. Got like a yeah, 10 minutes if you have like a freak coach who wants to make sure everybody is warmed up and everything.
How about
yeah.
20 plus minutes for stretch?
Yeah, that's a little excessive.
Well,
that's a little excessive.
Nation Hughes was talking after practice.
How can you not stretch right? Like, how the hell you mess up a stretch?
Nation Hughes was talking after practice. He said, well, the U of H guys were telling them their first practice under Tom Herman, their first stretch period lasted about 30 minutes. So at least they're a little bit ahead of the
See,
curve.
You know what that makes me think, though? That this is pre, you know, this is kind of predetermined by him. It's premeditated. It didn't matter how they stretched. They could have stretched like, you know, like yoga instructors. And he still, well, and you let me know if I'm wrong. From what I hear behind the burn orange curtain, he yelled a lot of screaming and yelling.
Yeah.
He likes to yell and scream. I like to yell and scream. I love yelling and screaming. And he likes to get it out, and he was going to get, like, his rant out regardless.
Set the tone. It was a tone
boom.
Setting.
That's why I think
tone setting
it didn't
here.
Matter how they stretched. They was going to get that rant. It's like when your woman's mad at you. Like, it don't really matter what you do when you come home. You're going to – it's coming. You know when it's – you're like, it's coming.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to get this wrath sooner or later. That's what it is with Tom Herman.
And it sounds like also it could have been something that's foundational, like in
– Yeah, start the building
the
process.
Because you'd hear about how detail-oriented and how much those things do matter, every little tiny granule – matters to Herman. So when it's that first one, I can easily see it being so. No, you have to be as meticulous as I tell you to be, or we're redoing it all over again.
The stretch period, though, like you said, man, it was meticulous. But the point he was trying to drive home was this staff doesn't miss anything. Like, they're not going to let up on the little details. And I thought it was interesting in his Monday press conference. He made reference to that sometimes staff members or people ask him, why do you make mountains out of molehills? So because he feels he has to. To get the point across that what you're asked to do in this program, you're going to do it the right way. If it's a 10-yard sprint and you know by his plus two method, that means don't let up till you get to 12 yards. if you let up before 10 yards, you're going to do it again. Mm-hmm. And you're going to do it again, and you're going to do it again. And I thought what was interesting is the assistant coaches were calling guys out. Nope, coach, they got to do it again. He let up too soon.
Yeah.
It's just those little details, man. And that's the kind of stuff the Texans have been missing on the field, Rod. It's interesting. His post-practice comments were, you know, guys sometimes question, how does this relate to football? And his, Tom Herman's mindset is, it has everything to do with football. Those little details, man, that's the stuff that Texas has been missing. When you look at all the close losses last season and you think, you know, man, one play here, if this thing goes different, if you don't get a penalty here that makes this, you know, a 35-yard field goal instead of a 30-yard field goal, just little stuff like that, that stuff adds up, man, and that's the stuff right now that he's trying to show these guys is so important. That's what makes the difference between win and lose. It's a cliche we talk about all the time, but really, how many times, Rod, are we watching a game during the fall, not just a Texas game, but any game, and you really start thinking, like, man, really is a game of inches.
Yeah, and it's interesting you brought up that the, you know, the assistant coaches are calling out guys, too. So, like, the philosophy trickles down, and how many times do we get on Charlie Strong about not personally get on Charlie Strong, but on this show to get on Charlie Strong about the details?
Mm-hmm.
Special teams, just for an example, special teams is all, it's a detail oriented phase of the game, period. It's all about details. Kicks being blocked because a guy doesn't, you know, he doesn't put his foot in the right place where his technique is off, or he doesn't shoot his hand, whatever it is. Those are details. But your assistant coaches are the ones who are teaching the details. It ain't Charlie. If Charlie was teaching details, personally, hell, details would probably be, you know, rectified like that. But it ain't him. It's his assistants. And how often do we get on Charlie about being a bad manager, not hiring and not developing coaches and not hiring the right coaches to teach his philosophy? It wasn't trickling down. So the point that you brought up that it really stood out to me is that not only was Tom Herman out there calling out people, but the assistant coaches understood. So it, like, the philosophy is trickling out, but it's all about you hear that a lot with, like, geniuses, right? Like that. And I'm not saying that he's like, oh, like Steve Jobs.
Well, he's in Mensa.
But he is in Mensa. Like, he is. Yeah, he's up there in terms of the IQ. And they're obsessed with the details. Like Steve Jobs, right? He was always obsessed with details, the color of his shirt, whether his shirt had a pocket on it or not. Like the weirdest stuff. It's like, why does that matter? It's like, well, the perception matters. Like the shape of the computer matters. And the fact the mouse had to be this shape. And people thought he was insane. He would send stuff back and they would lose millions and millions of dollars because he's like, nah, the shape of that is weird. Nobody wants to hold something that shape. You know what I mean? Like, right. People are like, that's crazy. Oh, the earplugs. No, the earplugs, they don't fit ears. That's weird. They fall out. You know what I mean? Like, people are like, that's crazy to be that into details. But it made Apple what Apple is today.
Right.
Like, now that Steve Jobs is gone, they are not into details, and they're not really as dominant as they once were.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, that genius, that's a factor of his being obsessed with those small things, but they do. They add up over time. I think his quote was, I don't want to wake up one morning and have to deal with a whole lot of molehills. He didn't say that. I'm paraphrasing. But right. He basically said, I don't want to wake up one day and have to deal with a ton of molehills because I didn't address it at the time. That's why I make mountains out of molehills, because I don't want to wake up one day and have 10 molehills to deal with. No, that's what Charlie was not into that. He did not make mountains out of molehills. And he woke up one day and had like 15 damn molehills to deal with. And it was like, well, ain't no way you can deal with all them molehills. You're screwed.
Yeah.
And it ended up in Kansas beating Texas. That's how, when you do, I'm serious. That's what happens when you don't make mountains out of molehills.
And when we were talking all last fall, and it seemed like an obvious thing to state it, but it really didn't matter that, you know, a whole is only a sum of its parts. And when you really do, like you say, have those little issues, or say if you have a ship that's sinking and all you're doing now is plugging those little holes, just mm-hmm. trying to catch up to get it back to being serviceable, instead of ever making sure that those holes aren't there, so then you can improve above the expectation.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you're just trying to get back up to mediocrity and fighting those holes the entire way and staying down below.
Agreed.
So, first practice was interesting from that standpoint.
I like it. Just I like it, man. I like it. Don't get comfortable. Nobody's comfortable now. Everybody in that program is on edge.
And yes. That's why.
And from what I heard about, from what I heard about Saban and like Stoops, everybody on that program is always on edge. You're never comfortable. You're never walking around there feeling really good about yourself. Even the good players are kind of freaking on edge. Belichick, right? Brady, and everybody's on edge around there because he don't give a damn who you are. Brady may be safe, maybe. Right now, like, well, he may get dumped for Garoppolo. Like, you never know. Mm-hmm. So you're always on edge. You're always freaking out. You're always paranoid about where you stand in a hierarchy, which means you're always working your ass off. You know what I mean?
Work paranoid.
Yeah, that's why which you... it's good. You've been in that your job before, right? Like, oh, yeah. Early on when you started, you were like, man, I gotta grind. Your woman's like, why don't you come home? Hey, you did. Hey, I gotta make sure I'm grinding. I gotta make sure I'm putting in 15 hours a day. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. And I think that's what Tom Herman wants, that philosophy.
So from that standpoint, the first practice was really interesting. And Rod, to that point, in terms of, you know, nobody getting preferential treatment, everybody's on the same level. Tom Herman admitted after practice, Shane Bouchel got ripped into as much as anybody for being careless with the football, because people need to understand this right now, because Tom Herman's made it clear, and he used Shane Bouchel as an example. There are two things that will get you in trouble real quick with this coaching staff: loafing and not taking care of the football.
Yep.
And Shane Bouchel was careless with the ball. And according to a direct quote from Tom Herman, every member of the offensive staff undressed him verbally.
Man.
For being careless with the football.
Really? It was like, really? They all got on him at what? That's crazy. Like,
but again, Rod, that's in the details. It's just setting the tone that these are the expectations and they're going to have to be met every day. It's not,
I wonder how it happened. I'm not saying you're right. I'm just saying, like, I wonder if they all yelling at one time.
At the same time,
or did they take
five,
turns?
Or did he screw it five times?
Was it an
Oregon?
Did Herman get on him and then he leave? And then Tim Beck come over there and get on him and then he leave? And then
they're
other
guys.
Everybody take turns on him? Or did they all do what? You know what I mean? Like, was it a Royal Rumble criticism? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I want to know now. They tag in and out.
It'd be like
Tom Herman do a little bit.
Where
then
you're
Tom
all
back,
yelling
Tim
at
Beck
the same
back.
Time.
Yeah, I just want to know what happened now. Now I'm interested. Yeah.
I just like the fact that, you know, the guys are being held. Everybody's kind of held to the same standard. I don't think – this is just my kind of spitballing here. I don't think it's going to be that way forever because, Rod, you've been around the game long enough. Coaches have their favorites.
Yes. And they will.
At some point, Tom Herman's going to have his favorites.
And once football happens, that's when favorites develop. Who performs?
Right.
And
I use this example all the time. And you know, Jimmy Johnson used to famously say, "He's like, if Troy Aikman's asleep in a meeting, I might just go nudge him and say, hey, wake up. You know, we're in a meeting. You know, I know you're tired, but why don't you go ahead and sit up?" But if it's John Roper, even though he had a newborn kid and slept 2 hours, if he's asleep in a meeting, you're gone.
And your dog cussed on your way out. You know what I mean? Like, no, but it's almost like, it's not that different. Right now, Tom Herman said in that press, the media availability that he had right before spring started, but he kept saying, but I don't know if he can play football. Or he would compliment, like, P.J. Locke. He'd say, P.J. Locke's great. Called his parents. Nation tell him
Hughes.
What it, Nation, those guys are great, but I don't know if they can play football. You know what I mean? Like,
talking about the person.
They seem awesome, but I don't know if they can play football. He kept saying that and repeating that. So I think he was doing that. He's a smart guy. He's doing that on purpose. Say, well, I don't know if they can play football. Once football starts, that's when I'll develop my favorite. That's why they have that champions, right. Like, you know, group and all that kind of stuff. That's when he'll develop his favorites.
The same way with Chris Warren. He's impressed with Chris Warren as an athlete. But he'll be a lot more impressed, as he said, if Chris Warren can lower his shoulder pads and run somebody over.
There you go. You know what I mean? That's where the fat shaming comes in of the D lineman.
Let's talk about that, man. Because that was the most kind of, I don't know, controversial or whatever word you want to put on it. But that was the one thing out of that press conference that popped. And it's interesting. It's interesting because we talked. I'd heard about it. You guys know I wrote about it last week. Tim was in here and talked about it. Tim Crowder was last week. The fact that these defensive linemen aren't built ideally the way Todd Orlando and Tom Herman would like them built. At U of H, they had smaller, leaner, sleeker guys up front. They didn't. I think they had maybe one or two guys on their entire roster in terms of defensive linemen that were 300-plus pounds. You know, Texas has three or four guys that are 330-plus.
Yeah, big guys.
So, and that's just a scheme thing. You know, they're going to slant their linemen a lot more and do some different things with them. And you want those guys to be leaner. And Rod, from
they do more stunts and
From this standpoint too, you think about this. And I don't know if this is something that I didn't hear the coaches say about this. This is kind of me spitballing it, just freestyling a little bit. In this league, when you lose the opportunity to substitute, you could be in one package, and you're forced to stay with that package for the duration
plays,
of a drive unless you call a timeout.
Great point. That's a great point. And you got to be not only well-conditioned, but you'd like them to be multiple in terms of the guys
right.
What they can do, and which means usually if you're 330 pounds, you ain't multiple. You
got a one. You're a one-trick pony.
Yeah, you do one thing well, that's it. And then you're right. Once an offense adjusts to it, and, you're screwed if you got to stay on the field.
You know, Oscar Giles said we had a defensive availability a few weeks ago. Oscar Giles said Ed Oliver played last year at about 275 for U of H.
Yeah.
People thought he was bigger. He played like he was bigger, but he's about 275, maybe 280. Go. That's the kind of guys Texas wants. But again, to your point, Rod, about the holding the assistant coaches accountable and coaching your coaches, Tom Herman basically said after practice yesterday, hey, it's on Pod Orlando and Oscar Giles to take this, and you guys got to make something of it. We don't have a waiver wire. Can't trade these guys. You can't cut and sign free agents.
He was brutally honest on that. I mean, he was basically saying, we got what we got, and it ain't great, but we going to do what we do.
And
it's like,
and even last night, you know, he talked about a couple of the linemen. He was asked about Jordan Elliott during winter conditioning, and it was kind of like almost a backhanded comment, like, you know, he goes hard for being as out of shape as he is. He tries really hard, you know. And he was talking, but he's praising Puna Ford from practice. He's like, you know, Puna Ford goes hard. He's not in great shape, but man, he goes really
it's
hard.
Almost like pimping. He's like pimping right now. Like he cannot give a compliment to somebody without degrading them at the same time. So it's what pimping is. I know it sounds crazy. What pimping is psychologically breaking someone down and building them back up, almost in your own image. Not that I'm a pimp, but you can argue, you can debate that. But to say, like, that's what he's doing. He's breaking these guys down. And no favorites. Shane Bouchel got under, you know what I mean? Like, so no favorites, and specifically D-line. So you know what I think the D-line thing is all about, though, Jeff? I think he likes this D-line. I think he likes the group. That's why I think he called them out specifically.
The motivation.
You look at it, I mean, this group was, not that they were that productive, but Texas led the Big 12 in, what, sacks and tackles for loss. Now, only 30% of those came from, like, true D linemen. Guys who were, like, hybrids, like Malcolm Roach and Brecken Hager. You take them out of the mix, the D line accounts for, like,
Nashawn Hughes, too, yeah.
Yeah, they account for, like, 30% of the sacks and the tackles for loss. So I think, number one, he said he has not watched film, right? I haven't watched any film. These guys suck. I ain't watched no film, though. They suck. I ain't watched no film, though. You know what I mean? Like, so he hadn't watched any film. So he's just saying, like, I don't like them. I don't like what I've seen. So I think there are a few things at work. I think he's looked at the stat sheet and been like, damn, they need to be more productive. Like, my D-line doesn't wreak enough havoc. And then when he went out and watched them work out, big boys, 330 pounds, he's like, that's why they ain't wreaking no havoc. They too fat. You know what I mean? Like, and I think one thing that also bothers him, and you think about this, and we've been talking about it. Every position for Texas, other than maybe, like, I don't know, kicker and tight end, all right, which Texas has been cursed on for a while, they have a leader or somebody you would project as the best player in that group, the playmaker, right? Every position almost.
Yeah.
Except D-line. Who's the best playmaker on the D-line? You know what I mean? Like, there really is no – exactly. And won't he don't even – hell, Tom Herman don't even know if Roach is a DN or a linebacker. Yeah, he was like – remember he, like, clarified? He's like, oh, I think he's a linebacker. He might be a DN.
We got clarification. Malcolm Roach is with the D-line.
Right? Like, D-line. But at this press conference, he didn't even know, right? So, guys, and Brecken Hager's kind of a hybrid guy,
same
too.
Same thing.
So, I think what
but Hager's starting out at inside linebacker.
Is now,
they've
but I'm just saying.
Yeah, he's
but,
the
but
same
in,
niche.
In the Charlie Strong defense. So, my point is, I think he looked at, like, stat sheets. I think he wants to wreak more havoc. I think number two is, he is pissed off at the previous regime a little bit. He's pissed off at them. He's pissed off with, and it's the same reason we're pissed off at them a little bit, their inability to adapt to this conference quick enough. Like, they didn't figure out that big 330-pound D lineman wasn't the way to go in the first year. You know what I mean? Like, that's research that isn't tough to do in a Big 12 conference that is past happy. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Know what I'm saying? And I think and this is, the Deontay Foreman kind of threw Texas under the bus too in Charlie Strong.
Yeah.
Remember he told Bob Ballou that nobody ever told him what to eat or told him how to eat at Texas. Now, I don't know what was going on behind the burn-on curtain because I wasn't there specifically, but it sounds like he's insinuating there was no dietitian or nutritionist.
Or no oversight from
them. Or regulation about what they were eating and educating them on how to eat it. I think that may be a little, and we know that Tomlin wants to beef up the support staff and all that kind of stuff, and I think it's frustration with Texas being behind the times. If Texas wasn't doing stuff like that, that means, once again, they're living in the Stone Age.
There is a nutritionist for the athletic department.
Yeah.
He wants a nutritionist for football specifically.
Yes, exactly. So I think that's more frustration right there with that whole thing.
That kind of leads me to one thing I wanted to talk to. Whatever you look at what he's done, we talked about facilities a lot the last few weeks and the renovations that are going on, and he's, you know, locker room. I'm trying to think, locker room. All the graphics on the walls. I think everything but the weight room should be done by, like, the early part of June.
Nice.
And then I think the weight room, because you're using it and whatnot, I think that's going to be a kind of a summer.
That's a bigger project, right. too. That's a much larger right. project.
But I think by like yeah. probably by the time you start fall camp, the weight room should yeah, be done. That's so, a much larger. So those improvements will be done.
And then
but,
you have to displace the guys while you do the weight room in terms of them working out. You know what I mean? So like that's a bigger project to figure out what.
But
to
you
do.
Talk about the other stuff, which to me is equally, if not more important than how nice your locker room is or how nice your weight room is. The athletic department has a nutritionist. He wants one for football.
Mm-hmm.
Hardy McCrary is the high school relations director for the entire athletic department.
Yeah.
That's cool, but I want my own. So he hired Bob Shipley.
Bob Shipley, baby. Yeah. It's always good to have a Shipley on campus.
I didn't know we said it. Yes.
Never a bad thing. You know, Shipley or Nacho, damn it, or McCoy.
The athletic department has graphics people.
Yeah.
I want my own graphics
my own
people
guy.
For football. Mm-hmm. I want them doing anything but yeah. football. And you think about it like this. Whether you're talking about improving the facilities, building a support staff, or dealing with your players, Tom Herman will never have more leverage than he's got right now.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
He's undefeated.
He's undefeated.
And, hadn't lost a game yet.
And he's coming off of the Charlie Strong regime, which
exactly.
a lot of people saw as a disaster. He's almost like, not that he's Obama. Remember, people were really upset about the George W. Bush campaign. You know, I mean, I would say his reign.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And the way it went down, they were upset about that, the war in Iraq and all that kind of stuff. And there's no doubt that that helped kind of galvanize Obama's hope and change movement.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost like Charlie Strong's disappointing regime on the 40 acres has helped galvanize the donors and the boosters and, you know, Mac Brown, the laws, like everybody is on board with whatever you need. And I heard that Tom Herman is taking advantage of it too. Like whatever you need,
oh, and that's smart.
We can, like, we'll get it done. We'll find a way to get it done because I think there's a little bit of, I don't know if it's remorse, but everybody pretty much who's in the know believes that Texas wasn't united behind Charlie Strong. And
right.
that's part of Steve Patterson, too. And I had my hatchet man theory about Steve Patterson that he was brought in just to really, you know, up the ticket price and do really unpopular things because nobody else wanted to do them. But the hires that he made ain't looking good. And you know what I mean? Like, it is that. So that whole era, I think Texas wants to get passed really quickly, which is not helping Shaka. And I think part of that is let's give Tom Herman the best young coach. We got the best young coach in college football. We got the guy. He's supposed to be Mac Brown, DKR, reincarnate. Let's give him everything he needs. No regrets. Because there are some regrets with Charlie on both sides. Charlie screwed up some things, and so did Texas on both sides.
Right. You know, yeah. We can have podcast upon podcast of why it didn't work for Charlie.
Yeah, yeah.
What did he ask for? What didn't he ask for? What was he allowed to do?
Yeah,
what was
yeah.
he not allowed to do? I think it's very clear, though, that the period of highest leverage Charlie Strong had, basically the time from the time he was hired until the time he played his first game, that period of time wasn't maximized.
Nope.
Because of regardless who the athletic director is,
agreed.
Rod, it's a business decision. It's much harder to get the things you want when you're not producing.
It's true, too. And it's harder to follow a legend. In sports,
yeah.
John Madani always had a great quote. You don't want to be the man that follows a legend in sports. You want to be the man that follows the man who follows a legend.
I'll give Charlie.
And that's what Tom Herman is.
I'll give Charlie Strong this publicly. And I know that he had a quote to, I think it was Sports Illustrated or somebody that Texas
yeah,
fans weren't too flattered about. To my knowledge, Charlie Strong hasn't thrown anybody at Texas under the bus.
No.
He hasn't thrown Steve Patterson under the bus.
Nope.
He hasn't said anything bad about Mike Perrin
That's
or Greg
true.
Fenves
yep.
or the boosters.
Nope.
He's pretty much just, you know, taking his lumps and he's gone on to Tampa.
Give me my golden parachute, baby.
That's pretty much been it.
Fly to Tampa.
And you could people can say what they want about that, but I find some honor in that he
well,
hasn't thrown anybody under the bus
too.
Or blamed anybody for his faults. It's
nope.
just like, hey,
no race card play.
Didn't
or
anything.
Work. It's all good.
Didn't win enough. Just didn't win. Didn't
Which
work.
Which makes him. I still. That's why Longhorn fans, I think, ultimately will look at the good things, like the cupboard
right.
being stacked. And that's what Tom Herman said. That he said. This team is so much more talented than the team that I had at U of H when I first got there. But conference is
different.
It's
relative.
Too.
It's relative.
To that
the
point,
play.
We were just talking about, though, Chris Hummer at the Horns 24/7 wrote a great column
yeah.
about Tom Herman, the politician. And he made some historical comparisons. I won't spoil it for folks out there. It's a great, you should go read it right now. Chris Hummer's great, it's fantastic. But Tom Herman he's using the leverage and the power that he has in his position, which is actually one of the most powerful men in college football. And he's using that From what I hear, not that he's deboing some people. He's punking some folks. he really is. Yeah. There have been a couple of times he tried to debo the media already. He's deboed, you know, obviously, and he's smart. And I'll say this to the point. He's learned that you can use the media to get your point across, even to players. I bet he didn't tell those guys they were fat. But he told the media, and he knows social media exists, and they'll get back to him that I said they were fat. And the guys like Malcolm Roach and the guys like Charles Amin, who they'll go, he ain't talking about me because I ain't 300 pounds. And the guys that are all 300 will go, damn, he talking about me. You know what I mean? So the message gets there without you having to have that awkward confrontation to go, man, you fat. You need to get it together. So I think he's a brilliant manipulator of the media and social media.
Yeah,
I
really do. Dane, the point you brought up with talking about how you see in presidential races, but just being able to seize the momentum that comes with the territory whenever you took over the job. And Tom Herman seems to be the type of guy that is trying to seize as fast as he can, because you look at how quickly these college programs that have been successful have turned around. It's like we said, you know, it is the few cases, but when they do it immediately, and it's because you do get that elite coach, but you only really have one opportunity to be that. Otherwise, then you become the Charlie Strong or the Will Muschamp, the hot commodity that falls off real quickly, because nowadays you only have that tiny window at the front.
That's true.
So, yeah, so that's kind of my take on it. And I just retweeted a link to Chris's column so you guys can
go check it out. It's really good.
It's on my Twitter feed right now. Those of you guys are following me on
it's
Twitter.
It's a hell of a hot take. I think it's fantastic. I'm using it on the show today. It's great.
But, yeah, I mean, Chris kind of gets into what I was talking about, that he's not going to have more leverage than he has right now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was actually talking to somebody on the phone about this on the drive over here. We're talking about Tom Herman's leverage and talking about this very subject. And the sales pitch of the player, you know, he's gotten so many questions about buy-in. And my response to that is, what if you're a player at Texas, what other choice do you have? You know, Tom Herman's response, if you don't want to buy in, okay, fine. You go sit over there. You like
watch
seven lost seasons.
Yeah.
You want to sit at home during bowl season. Go right ahead. You go keep doing what you're doing, and you go sit right over there. All these guys, they want to win. They're tired of being embarrassed. But you go do your thing. You don't want to do it.
Definition of insanity. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead and go back and watch us win. I agree with you. I don't think the buy-in is tough at all.
No, it shouldn't be.
What did Tom Herman say? He asked everybody who had a winning – who's ever had a winning season before they used to raise their hand.
Yeah.
I want to say it was like four or five guys that raised their hand. Oh,
it
would have
been the guys that were here for 2013.
Yeah,
because nine of them redshirted and then
so I may be off about the number, but I think it was single digits. That was his point. And it was like, ain't a lot of guys had winning seasons on the 40 acres.
It's like now that Jake Oliver's gone, it's like Mitchell Becker,
it's like
Mayshon Hughes and Antoine Davis. I think that's
like,
it.
Yeah, it's like four or five guys raised their hand. I think that's the answer to your question. It ain't a tough buy-in.
That's Texas.
Texas. They are starting to feel that weight, and I think
it's nuts.
They're starting to feel that weight of losing. And, you know, this process, as he says, is going to be really hard. He's warned the guys, because I think Tom Herman, that's why he wants to make it really difficult on everybody, because he understands how difficult it is to win at Texas.
It's hard, man, because you look, going back to what we're talking about recruiting,
he remembers.
If you look at recruiting, 8-5 is not going to do a whole lot for him.
What? It ain't going to do nothing. He's got this year, he's doubling down all of his efforts on 2018 from recruiting. Am I right about that? Because 2017 was supposedly a disappointment. Not in his eyes. He methodically
they like some of the guys
everybody,
they got,
whatever. But you get my point about recruiting rankings. So from what I heard, it's all about doubling down their efforts is what they did on 2018, because they saw that swoon coming in 2017. They're not idiots. They're smart. They saw it coming. So they have to win 2018. Now, I agree with you. Not eight wins for Charlie was going to be acceptable. Not for Tom Herman. The expectations are high. He wants them high.
Yeah.
So I agree with you. I think 9 wins is what people are thinking for the regular season.
I think nine and 4 is going to have to be the minimum to move the needle.
I agree. I think 9 wins is what people are saying. And you know what? I don't have a problem. I've always said this. It ain't tough to turn around blue bloods, man. And that's my thing about Charlie. Remember, I sat down on that show several times. I was like, man, Charlie's on the wrong trajectory. Because with a blue blood, usually those turnarounds, first 2 years is when they happen, and you see it.
We talk about that with recruiting, too, right?
Right.
Like, it's Texas. You should be able to get
Penn
recruits.
State, for God's sake. Penn State! They had a child molestation scandal, okay?
Yes.
All right? Recovered like that, okay?
That's pretty rough.
Look at USC. Look at where they were, in the toilet. One guy comes along, right guy, boom, turns around like that. Florida, Ohio Michigan, State. Ohio State. It doesn't take long with a blue blood, man. So that was my only complaint about Charles. Like, Charlie's taking a while, man. And he's acting like he's got a while. Remember we always said he acted like he had the luxury of time? It's like he took his time. Like, yeah, you know what? I think I'm going to change his OC. It might be about that time. No, change it now. Do it now. What are you doing? But Tom Herman seems the opposite. He seems like a panic guy. Like, do it now. Let's do it now. Like, why are you making a mountain out of a molehill? No, shut up. Let's do it now. Let's take care of it now. I love it. I love it. I think
very
Longhorn fans,
generational.
We've been thirsting for that, man. We got Charlie. He was all lackadaisical and like cool. He was like, no, we are panicked here, man. We are freaking out. Longhorn fans are freaking out. All right. A&M's coming up. TCU, Baylor. We are freaking out. And I like, he's kind of freaky. He's like neurotic. He's the same neurotic, the same level of, you know, kind of paranoia and neurotic behavior that Longhorn fans are exhibiting in the last 3 or 4 years under Charlie. So I like it.
And that just fits him and, like, say, I mean, he's the first of almost your generation. I mean, he's about our age. So it's like he's almost a millennial coach, and Charlie definitely a generation behind. And you had a lot more time in previous generations. Nowadays, you don't.
Nope.
And it thinks as if our coach at least understands that as much as anybody else.
I like it, man. I like him.
So
I'm happy where everything's happening.
I guess that's going to wrap it up for this week's show. Don't have a whole lot to talk about. We're going to have plenty of more spring ball to talk about. Now, here's the way the spring schedule is going to work. So they'll go on Thursday. Next week is spring break. So they're off. And then they'll come back after that and hit the ground running until the spring game.
Pro day is what, March 28th?
28th, yes. So
okay,
that
so
is...
we have another Okay, we could do something before then. All
right. We're talking about with
I don't even know who's going to be at Pro Day. Deontay Foreman. Who's performing?
Hey, he'll do his 40. You'll
I mean,
get that 40.
You know, you get the Kent Perkins and Dylan Haynes. And,
Dylan Haynes! Dude, I am really looking forward to Dylan Haynes, baby.
You got to show up this time, Rod.
You know
be
what?
There.
I got to come show Dylan Haynes some love. Because Longhorn fans are very racist about Dylan Haynes. That's where I said it. Yes. I said you're racist, Longhorn fans, because you hate white safeties. Dylan Haynes, Blake Gideon, you guys always hating on them. Oh, they're not that good. Those guys are awesome. Both of them are awesome. It's one of the greatest DBs in the history of DBU. So Dylan
can't
Haynes.
Can't get past the color of their skin.
Yeah,
I just want to know this right now.
Sam Ellinger, Dylan Haynes. That Twitter spat. Hey, I love you, Dylan Haynes. I love all you guys.
We
DBU
are
for life.
About 3 weeks away, a little over 3 weeks, less than 3 weeks away from Pro Day. Rod, are you guaranteeing us that we will get a Rod Baber sighting in the bubble at Pro Day?
Oh, that it. You know what? I don't even know.
I think last time you were there was Mike Tomlin.
I don't know if I can guarantee it. Oh, that's a good question. I would love to go, though, to
Kenny
Pro
Vaccaro's
Day.
Pro like Day was the last time I think I saw Rod.
And this is
40.
Like a terrible Pro Day. It's like the worst Pro Day that Texas had in a long time. Right? It's like bad Pro Day.
It's like a gathering of all your former players.
It's
So, you know what? Maybe I'll show up there. I don't know. Maybe I should show up to kind of, you know,
start the trend on social media. Rod to Pro Day.
I want to wear my Longhorn Lucha Libre mask. Oh, that's the only way I'll go if somebody find me a Longhorn Lucha Libre mask.
Apparently, if you go to luchadors.com, you can find one.
Somebody said that?
Somebody said that on the Facebook Live.
Nice. They got actually licensed ones, not the non-cease-and-desist of Mexico.
El luchador neglón.
Yes, sí. Bueno, bueno.
Matt, thanks for everything, man.
Hey, you're more than welcome.
Rod B, appreciate the time and the knowledge.
Anytime, brother.
For Matt, for Rod, for Travis, for everybody at AM 1300 The Zone, AM1300TheZone.com, where you can hear this podcast each and every week. And thanks to Matt, you get us on iTunes, TuneIn, SoundCloud, any podcast app.
Yep, just type in Longhorn Blitz.
For the Zone family, for the Horns 24/7 family, I am Jeff Howe. Thank you so much for downloading and listening, and we will catch you again on the next episode.
You've been listening to Longhorn Blitz with Horns247.com. Remember, for the latest Longhorn news 24/7, visit Horns247.com.